Let's face it, many of us don't follow the best diets, especially if you're in the US. And with that, our bodies may be lacking in certain essential vitamins and minerals. So we're getting enough things like folate and iodine, but when it comes to dietary fiber, potassium, magnesium, calcium, and iron, it seems some of us might be lacking in these nutrients or just unsure if you are or not. In fact, in a recent poll, we find that 86% of Americans take some type of vitamins or supplements, yet only 21% have a confirmed nutritional deficiency, which shows people still take supplements without ever knowing they may be actually deficient or not in the supplement that they're taking. And with that said, in this crazy supplement-driven world where there seems to be a supplement for everything these days, it's important to know which supplements to not take together. So in this video, we will go over what those five common supplement combos are to avoid. If you guys are new here, my channel is all about helping you make informed decisions about your health and wellness. And I'd love for you all to gently tap on the like button down below. And if you really like the content, then consider subscribing. Also, if you're on Instagram, you can follow me there too. Now, without wasting any more time, let's dive right in. The reason why this topic is important is because let's say whether you take a daily multivitamin to enhance your overall health, or you rely on herbal supplements to fill in nutritional gaps, you gotta know of the possible interactions that come with them. And you might be thinking, what about multivitamins then? If you're saying nutrients can negatively interact with one another, then how are multivitamins even on the market? That's a good question. Well, the reason why they are allowed is because most multivitamins are formulated in a special way so that it counteracts any potential negative nutrient-nutrient interactions, so nutrients don't compete with each other. I'll give you an example. We know that magnesium can improve vitamin D levels, right? But vitamin A can decrease vitamin D uptake. That's a problem. So to work around this, you'll almost always find that the percentage daily value of vitamin D is higher than vitamin A on most of your multivitamin nutrition labels. And while there may be more than just these five interactions, I decided to focus on the major ones that I see people taking most often, starting with the first one being calcium and magnesium. You see, magnesium is needed for calcium absorption, and because magnesium suppresses parathyroid hormone and stimulates calcitonin, it helps deposit the calcium into the bones, which will help prevent osteoporosis, right? So without magnesium, too much calcium would become toxic then, depositing in the soft tissue leading to arthritis. So you think to take them together then, right? Well, it turns out taking large amounts of them both can reduce their absorption. I'm not saying you have to avoid them altogether, but in order to maximize your calcium and magnesium supplement benefits, why not just aim to take them at least 2 hours apart? Or take the calcium in the morning while the magnesium at night, let's say if you're taking magnesium L-threonate for sleep. The second one is iron and green tea. And there was this idea that green tea only interacted with non-heme iron, which is the iron you get from non-animal sources, which is the same iron, by the way, that they say to drink orange juice with to increase absorption. But this study titled Iron Deficiency Anemia Due to Excessive Green Tea Drinking showed us that recent experiments on human intestinal monolayer cells have provided evidence that dietary polyphenolic compounds, which are in green tea, could interfere with absorption of both heme and non-heme iron across these cells, which is why if you are a chronic green tea drinker, it is more likely that you develop an iron deficiency anemia. But does that mean you should stop drinking green tea? Not quite, because we do know that the EGCGs in green tea are very beneficial for you. Plus, the study was on excessive green tea. But how much is excessive, right? That's hard to gauge. What we have is the 2015 Dutch dietary guidelines that recommend drinking 3 cups of tea daily based on cohort studies indicating that consumption of tea was associated with a lower risk of stroke and diabetes. So anything over 3 cups a day can be used as a benchmark as potentially excessive. The third is vitamin D and calcium. And there's two things to note with this one. Vitamin D and calcium are a team. Vitamin D helps our bodies absorb calcium, but if you have too much vitamin D in your blood, it will cause extra calcium absorption, which can lead to muscle pain, mood disorders, kidney stones, etc. There's actually a term for it. It's called hypervitaminosis D, where your levels are 100 nanograms per milliliter or more, usually caused by oversupplementation, which comes from a crazy recommendations that you hear all over TikTok, telling you to take probably more than what you really need. And with all the hype around vitamin D, it's important that you are at least aware that it increases your calcium levels at the same time. And if you're already taking high amounts of calcium, you might run into some trouble, which you know can easily be prevented. Secondly, and this comes from the NIH, if you are overweight or have obesity, taking vitamin D at doses above 20 micrograms or 800 IU per day plus calcium might actually raise your blood pressure. The fourth one, in which you might never have thought of, is melatonin and St. John's wort or valerian root or any other supplements that are said to put you to sleep. And with the global melatonin market reaching almost 4 billion by 2030, more and more people are desperate to get a good night's rest and will sometimes combine that with sedating herbs at the same time. And if you listen to Dr. Huberman's work, you know he's not a fan of exogenous melatonin at all, stating that 3 to 6 milligrams is already a massive dose and not all supplements contain what they say that they contain, even to have melatonin lowers baseline dopamine levels. So just be careful with these combos because they can also lead to daytime drowsiness when you wake up, which isn't a nice feeling at all. And lastly, fish oil and ginkgo biloba. You would think many take fish oil for their heart health benefits, but actually some take it for weight loss, vision, and even neurocognitive injury. And if you've heard of ginkgo biloba, you know people take it for cognitive function. Even though studies are mixed, they both can cause a blood thinning risk. And this is why it might be best to avoid them taking them at the same time. And remember, it's always best to speak to your doctor to make sure that the supplements you are taking have the benefits outweigh their risks. And a good rule of thumb is to let them know before starting any to make sure you are the right candidate to take them, because supplements don't just interact with supplements. They can also interact with your medicines too. I'm more curious to hear from you guys though. Click that subscribe button if you found any value in this video, and I'll see you on the next one.